insights from the world's best medical minds. You are watching TheRightDoctors.com.
Hello, everybody. It's nice to be here, and we'd like to introduce ourselves before we take this session ahead. I have with me Dr. OP Yadava, and it's my privilege to both be associated with him and introduce him. He is the CEO of National Heart Institute in Delhi and has an exemplary background in both the armed forces and in a medical career, in addition to his administrative hat, which he holds right now. I am Dr. Ravindra Mehta. I am a pulmonary critical care physician trained in India and in the US, and currently employed with Apollo Hospitals in Bangalore. And we are here to talk on the topic of the decade or the century at this point, COVID-19, and of course, some specific aspects to it. What we're addressing today is cardiopulmonary manifestations of COVID-19. And that is something we'd like to take up in this brief discussion, taking advantage of existing knowledge and, of course, the Dr. Yadav's perspective and what I can add in the midst of the huge amount of knowledge and information which has inundated us. So to go back to this, I'll just give a brief summary before we take up the discussion. COVID-19, everyone knows well about what's going on. The treatment, the clinical manifestations and treatment has been one of the fastest moving thing that medicine has ever seen. We have never seen the urge to come out with explanations and therapies and the acceptance of that so fast, so quick, and in such a knee-jerk fashion, largely because of the speed of the disease and the overwhelming need to try and find some explanations and some therapies, which is going to prevent the deluge of morbidity and mortality, which we thought the disease will get. Indeed, it has been a problem. We flip from the fact that it doesn't have such a high mortality. On the other hand, it's killing people like crazy out there, and the COVID clock is watched with concern by everybody in the world at this point. And so with this entire background, the idea is to spend some time to try and understand some physiological aspects which may help us in the thinking process. Cardiopulmonary interaction manifestations or processes is what we will briefly discuss today. Since it's a respiratory disease, a lot of the initial thing was that it's like any acute lung injury, but more and more has come out in this. It has now moved from the typical quintessential cut and paste regular ARDS to much more than that. And we use this as an opening dialogue to take the session ahead. Dr. Yadav, your take on this fact, what started off as a upper respiratory going on to lower respiratory infection and which led to this clarion call of ventilators has now taken a shift in some other direction. Would you like to tell us something more about that?
Sure. You know, as you put it very, very succinctly and quite brilliantly, this is a disease which is affecting us medically, socially, and virtually any and every organ of the body today has been implicated as far as the manifestation of COVID is concerned. So though the primary mode of entry is obviously the oral cavity and the lung pneumocytes and the vascular endothelial lining there, but there is no organ which is spared. And the ultimate we have in cardiology is the Kawasaki kind of a disease. And they're saying there is a multi-system inflammatory response. So the kidneys have been involved in these. And renal failure is one of the important modes of death. We have had strokes, both small blood vessel and large blood vessel involvement. An absolute plethora of cardiac manifestations and pulmonary. Obviously, you are the master. And it has been the primary focus of this virus are the lungs. So it's virtually devastated us on all fronts medically. But, you know, going by non-medical also, even economically and socially, it's divided us. You know, the divide has been so severe, much more severe than even, you know, the divide of the caste system of the those kind. But here, the COVID and the non-COVID divide, the haves and the have-nots divide, the migrants and the non-migrant divide. So it's devastated us in more than one ways.
So, a good way of putting things into perspective. Now, when we get on to the further physiological aspects, which have been both confounding as well as provocative, we have now realized that this is now a very systemic sort of inflammation. So Dr. Yadav's keyword, inflammation, and he touched on various areas. When he mentioned the kidney and he talked of this Kawasaki-like thing. This Kawasaki-like thing has come now as a delayed thing, and it's come in the pediatric population. The one population we thought was actually spared of the dire and severe manifestations of COVID, they're seeing a delayed syndrome, which is akin to this, like a vasculitis, and more is being looked into, researched, and this space has to be carefully observed to see what's going on, but it's put a concern element, albeit with a lower incidence. But on the regular spectrum, what we have actually been dealing with a lot is that beyond the pulmonary system, the words which have been used is, of course, primary cardiac involvement, and then this entire vascular involvement, which is becoming an issue. So Dr. Yadav, this cardiac involvement of COVID-19, would you like to tell us something more about that?
Well, that's a very protean manifestations. You know, the prime thing has been the so-called, what you call, a myocardial injury. We have found that there is a raised levels of cardiac troponins or cardiac enzymes, but on angiography, the coronary arteries are totally normal. So it is not an atherosclerotic plaque related, what typically we call the type 2 myocardial infarction. It is more of a supply demand imbalance type 1 myocardial infarction or myocardial injury. Then we have, you know, arrhythmias of all kinds. We have bradyarrhythmias, tachyarrhythmias, supraventricular and ventricular arrhythmias, and the number one in this is atrial fibrillation. And some of these arrhythmias are also related to the drug intake, you know, hydroxychloroquine and azithromycin combination. It has been shown in one of the studies that if both drugs were taken together, then there was an extremely high incidence of ventricular arrhythmias, and both the mortality was increased. So if you had only HCQS, 8.4% were ended in fatal events, but if you were taking azithromycin, 20% of these ended, you know, with death or mortality. And the mortality was 2 times higher and arrhythmias 20 times higher if the two were taken together. So we all know that the WHO has withdrawn that study called the Solidarity Study, or withdrawn the enrollment of that study. So arrhythmias are another big problem, whether spontaneous or drug induced. Then we have cardiomyopathies like situation, you know, this could be a stress cardiomyopathy. It could be cytochrome sepsis combination producing a cardiomyopathy, and heart failures tend to become worse, and thromboembolism seems to be becoming the sign of quinon of this pathology of COVID-19, and microvascular as well as macrovascular. So it's across a wide platform that cardiac manifestations are presenting. And Kawasaki, we just mentioned. And Kawasaki is not just children. In fact, lately, just about 3 or 4 days back, they've reported Kawasaki-like syndrome even in adults. So that's kind of worrying, the kind of inflammation it produces.
Yeah, that's interesting. You started using protean, I think you described the protean manifestations. So, you know, interesting and excellent science, but very concerning clinical ramifications when you understand that it's just not a virus which is doing lung stuff, as we saw with other areas like H1N1 and all. This one is actually working through that dreaded word called systemic infection. And that is what's creating a problem everywhere. As he rightly pointed out, you know, it's the cardiac manifestations are both, you know, the muscle is involved, the arrhythmogenic component, the vascular component, and not the atherosclerotic component as we talk about. So that's something we have to keep in mind when we both see a patient at the same time, figure out what to do with them. Now, on the other fronts, the pulmonary fronts, the pulmonary vascular fronts, to add a little to what he already outlined and touched on, is that this is the vascular component is getting to be a big problem, because originally we like to compartmentalize things. We like to think that this is an alveolar interstitial pathology. This is going to be a vascular pathology separately. But when an inflammatory response tends to cause varying amounts of both, then the treatment becomes more complicated. And this is what we're seeing right now. Various fancy terms have come to describe the pulmonary vascular components of COVID, and it's been called pulmonary vasoplegia. It has been called the syndrome of pulmonary endotheliolitis, and so on and so forth, which leads to pulmonary vascular thrombosis. So all these terms, vasoplasia, vascular thrombosis in the pulmonary bed, as well as endotheliolitis, are indicating an inflammatory thrombotic process. So inflammation, triggering of thrombosis, leading to clot occlusion, which leads to manifestations such as hypoxemia, sudden deterioration, sudden death, requirement for ventilators, and so on. It has been extremely challenging to both understand these and predict these. To add to what I'm saying right now, these manifests have led to high amount of confusion, where when you're trying to treat patients, are you going to treat the antiviral element, which everyone's focusing on with medications? Or are we trying to treat an undiagnosed thrombotic element, which is difficult to catch and we have only indirect markers? Or are we going to treat the damage to the lung, which is either secondary to the inflammation or direct because of virus damage? It's been very difficult to figure out. And then this interacting with the manifestations in the heart, which Dr. Yadav mentioned, has made it a potpourri, which has made COVID-19 not the regular cut and paste in algorithmic disease, but has led to a high amount of clinical acumen at the bedside to try and figure out in the sick population. In the not so sick population, fortunately, we're quite okay. So this sort of disease spectrum, Dr. Yadav, you've been around for a long time. Have you seen viruses commonly doing this and confusing the world community at large, that we're changing our recommendation week, and you know, center A of eminence is not doing what center B of eminence is doing, and guidelines are also coming like a dime a dozen, like wickets in a T20 match?
Well, certainly not. Obviously, it has been, as you use the word right in the beginning, or the phrase, it's been a knee-jerk reaction from a lot of us. And even when we are talking, I'm not convinced what we are talking is hardcore science, because it's, lots of it is based on, you know, level C data or level C experiences, anecdotal experiences. We are talking of pulmonary endotheliolitis. Now, that word has arisen from an autopsy series in NAGM of 7 patients, just 7 patients. And they've come out with new terms like intussusceptive angiogenesis and vascular endotheliolitis and microangiopathies. So, you know, because of the fear which has been driven, and in fact, there was a very nice study which came, and a lady, I think, from USA epidemiology department, who said the biggest virus has been the Imperial College of London, which gave out the first figure of 2.2 million deaths, which created all this fear in the world, and the data flying so much without any evidence base for it. And today that has become the biggest danger lurking, that there is more data than we need. Having said that, have we seen that earlier? Yes, MERS came, SARS came, but they were obviously in a localized domain, and they were not as widespread as this one. This is pandemic, those were epidemics. So this is an unprecedented one. I agree with that.
So interesting. So I think to summarize an interesting discussion, we started off time to talk of the cardiopulmonary manifestations or occasions of COVID-19. Dr. Yadav brought out a very interesting aspect initially about, of course, the fact that this is way above and beyond what we're trying to localize on. The disease has an impact which has been unprecedented in a century. We then went on to discuss cardiac manifestations, which are largely non-atherosclerotic, and they are related to myocarditis, to arrhythmias, to medication effect, which he very importantly pointed out, which is becoming the hub of discussion the last week or two. And then, of course, the thrombotic component, which is part of a generalized inflammation. This word inflammation was reiterated, and its manifestations are also there in the pulmonary circulation, where these fancy words, you know, you like catchy words, but they at the same time leave as much in doubt as they clarify. So either we're talking endotheliolitis, which is an inflammation. So are we talking inflammation followed by thrombosis, or are we talking a primary thrombosis with sequelae anywhere else? It's difficult to figure out. So the pulmonary vascular component, as we said, has been a mixture of endotheliolitis or inflammation, thrombosis with its ramifications, not only in the pulmonary circulation, but rest of the body. And that is why people also talk, we're seeing strokes with COVID-19, we're seeing renal involvement of an inordinate nature, and so on. So this inflammatory thrombotic phenomena is a systemic phenomena, of course, with the lung being a major part of what is hitting everybody in the clinical treatment protocols and observations worldwide. So bottom line, COVID has now shown itself to be what tuberculosis used to be called, the master mimic. That because of multiple arenas in which it is acting, the inflammation, thrombosis, and a systemic spread, it is involving many organs, and each organ system is being looked differently from the point of view of how to understand, how to treat, and how to prevent in a major way. I think this is science in progress. As we talked about, this is going to keep going on. And this is something which has to be reviewed periodically so as to both understand it better and put in better treatment aspects on the ground. So this would be a summary of what we have discussed today. Dr. Yadav, if you have any further closing comments, we'll be happy to listen to you. Otherwise, we will close this discussion.
Well, I think, Ravi, you have summed it up beautifully. And it's, you know, it's not only just the acute manifestations that we have been always debating, you know, in all the literature that we have gone up today. We seem to be fighting the fire. But at some stage, we will have to think of what are the residual effects of this virus, because there is some evidence, at least from cardiac manifestation, that some of these changes that we are talking of, the especially the RV dysfunction, that seems to be lasting for at least more than a month. You know, in a very recent study from China, the Wuhan study, they found that roughly 58% of the patient on an MRI study in the follow-up period had late gadolinium enhancement suggestive of a fibrosis, and diffuse myocardial edema was found in 58%. So there is going to be lasting legacy of this besides, you know, the acute manifestation. And that's another arena we will have to at some stage address once we get on top of the so-called firefighting mode that we seem to be in. Well,
I think that sums it up very well. I think that it's not only short-term, but long-term. And he has pointed out cardiac, of course, lung is extremely concerning. A fibrotic lung, you know, hardly ever comes back, which may be the long-term sequelae of the disease once we cross this major hurdle, which we are dealing with right now. So I think we end this session. Thank you very much, Dr. Yadav. It's a pleasure to meet you and hear your thoughts, and extremely illuminating and adding to the knowledge spectrum which is there. We hope this is going to be useful to everybody. Have a lovely day.
Insights from the world's best medical minds. You are watching TheRightDoctors.com.